been apparently recording the video without any voice. My microphone was turned off. Anyway, yeah, I'm gonna probably do a couple of replays in succession because it's already coming up to the qualifier date. Well, it's not qualifier, it's finals already. So yeah, my goal is to actually, you know, learn as much stuff as I can for myself. So I'm just basically gonna go through a bunch of replays, maybe skip a bunch. Not gonna analyze something simple and gonna, you know, focus on big things that are new to me. Some way I can improve my play, or I can, you know, learn from someone else, or learn in a positive way, or see their mistakes. So I'm not gonna, you know, focus on basic things, and I'm probably not gonna be quite as talkative as I tried to be in the previous replay analysis. Alright, so this is Magic against Ted, and Ted is going 1 factory, and Magic is going, I assume, Mother first. This is actually a very tricky map for me. I played against Dot Dash here, and there might be different passageways that would work out for a good player, but going to the middle and yeah. I used to think it was a good idea to do the fight and go for the brush and the mountains to climb on, but you know, just, you know, actual application of that sort, application of my strategies against that dash, you know, in practice, I just saw that it's completely impossible to beat any kind of beta rush when you're in the middle. That's good. So, and Magic is running away, but I assume that he didn't see that Ted was going for hangar. I'm not sure if this is actually entirely correct. And that's anyway, yeah, and the Ted is doing some weird dueling he's doing now, and I just don't think it's good. I mean, that dash was going double factory and hangar, and honestly, if the map allows for it to be successfully executed, which pretty much most of the map, you know, except for like Edge of Winter, maybe Coastlands, you know, if a map allows that kind of thing to be executed, you're dead. So, you know, third factory just seems excessive. Puts him in -2, I'm not sure. Yeah, so what's talking about? Actually, I suggested to Magic that he should practice a large portion of that. I wasn't sure how effective it was, but I never think I liked it, so, you know, I told Magic, you know, maybe that's what he should do, you know, try something like that. But that's not how you do it. I actually don't think I ever done it against double racks. And if... it should work. Another point in this strategy, the key point in the strategy is that you need to bring your mother with you. Obviously, Magic couldn't be doing that, but generally speaking, large protein rush would not work unless you place your mother goo on top of their extractor. You know, you want to, you need to prevent their income, so you need to kill that thing. But maybe it's important, so I understand why. Right, yeah, that's a good part. He kills the one and only. Does crescents. Under normal circumstances, I would understand crescents because crescents can go uphill. So you hide uphill and you know, pellet their tier 1 units with your siege units, which is always good. But There are no mountains that are unreachable by commanders, and Father Ted has Stratus. So. On the other hand, you know, what else are you gonna do? You know, no other. Actually, no, Dwellers. Dwellers? Dwellers might have worked out very well because you would get two smalls. I don't know, actually. I mean, you're sort of behind with this situation. I sort of hope that Ted makes a mistake and walks his commanders into your Dwellers. Distractors, I think, would die very easily to commanders. And you cannot push commanders away with the matter at this point because it just has too little. So that might very well be the best. No, it can't be the best because you know, it's dodgeable. Those shots are dodgeable. On different stuff, yeah, I would agree with that. Sure, Ted is doing as well. Well, it's working out a lot better. I think if Ted splits, he would have had this. I think maybe if he indicated last quarter and he for a couple of commanders, he could make it right now. But yeah, I think this map actually allows for large protein rushes. I think the passageway to your opponent's base is quite crooked, so it can't be as effective as on some other maps, like Coastlands maybe or something like that. Alright. Let's check out this game, I suppose. Kuji back to playing Goon, which is I'm not sure if it's great to see, if it's bad to see. Obviously his beta wasn't as good as his Goon. It's good to see, you know. People who play Goo, you know, they stand together. Jamie Foxx rescues person from burning car. Good on Jamie. So Coastlands, decent map, I think, since beta. I mean, beta rushes are still pretty strong on this map, but I think, you know, the whole way that this was designed, this area was designed, actually make this map in a certain way almost balanced. Because, you know, you can rush as beta, but, you know, you can rush as blue versus blue, but all the passageways of the distance from figure to figure, they're cleverly designed, they're pretty close, and they're out of sight, and there are a lot of hiding areas. I think if the main locations had been designed better, maybe extra spigot or two, I think this would be the most balanced map. Because just addresses exactly the kind of issues that people have these days and their rushes. And it also has cleverly arranged passageways, so you know you can set up some kind of surround and stuff. I really like the design of the city. Difficulty actually, I think coastlands are also good for large protein rush either, because large protein rush is oftentimes executed on maps with a fast second extractor, fast second refinery, so you get a chance to catch them off guard. You can attack two of their mining locations with your mother and alright, the pass was decent. There aren't many options, so I would probably just go maybe straight here. I think this is dangerous. I mean, if you get caught over here by a commander, you're dead. The game is over, because it will just, you know, dish out so much damage on your mother that you don't even be able to produce anything meaningful. I mean, good on magic for trying. Yeah, this just becomes very delayed. Even commander is sort of become effective against the large protein at this point. Double factory open like that? Where's the double factory? You're going on defense and alright, so Bike Rush is playing with his Smurf. Because Magic yesterday just put out a beating on him. I think Magic went like 6-3 or something like that. So yeah, Bike Rush was forced to go with Smurf. Alright, let's check out Popeye versus Matisse. Alright, so Popeye versus Matisse, and Popeye is an advantageous position because the top gets faster to the middle, so gets the middle speed gets faster, so it's, it has more bank, so it would win in a lockdown fight. So yeah, I think middle. Bottom is at a bit of a disadvantage, but I mean, these days the goal is, as I said before, my replays, the goal is to not lock your mothers. So it doesn't really matter all that much. That bonus pull, if you don't lock, and if you keep your mother close to the spigot at all times, it's not really that important. Oh, this pig, this one goes to this one. Wait, does top get there faster? No, bottom gets there faster, right? I'm getting confused. Bottom gets to the middle faster. So yeah, so it's Popeye who's accepts the fact that he's gonna have a supplement, because I said, you know, as long as you keep it next to the spigot, as long as you keep your mother next to the spigot, not a problem. Just so you distract them myself. I mean, obviously, bank is always good to help you with your mother and, you know, you can't do it because Popo is just staying here. That's interesting. That's unusual, I'd say. I see a lot of people when they can't grab the middle position, sometimes they would they'll just go here. Maybe even here. Staying in the middle is brave. With right micro keys. So Popeye gets his first protein bits. Because he lost Strider to Matisse's mother, but then Matisse returned the favor. I understand why Popeye lost it, because those vent plugs, the rock formations on top of Catalyst, they always make their hitbox is a lot larger than it appears, and also it freaks out the pathfinder. Some reason, maybe they will probably edit after, you know, whatever pathfinding algorithms were set. After that, they edit vent plugs. So, vent plugs make your pathfinding freak out. So, yeah. Basically, I think Popeye didn't really miss micro here when he lost his Strider to the mother. I think what actually happened was that he basically doing everything correctly, just the catalyst vent. Got caught on it through no fault of his own. But Matisse still has bonus pool, has more HP on his mother. There is still a chance here. I don't think the luck in here is actually correct, because from what I've seen, when your mother gets to lower HP, it gets smaller in size. And actually its hitbox gets smaller in size. So whenever I catch a mother like that without vision, it can always escape after a while. You know, you have to chase it down. If you're not chasing it down, because the way the mothers work when they decouple is that they move little by little, and you can chase them and keep locking them, but you have to like be right clicking on them, you know, spamming right click, and that actually forces both mothers to shift slightly. So your mother would shift from down the this building, whatever it's called, and it would come into the range of the Strider, and you would lose. And if you just lock on top and don't, you know, spam right click on your enemy's mother, then usually decoupling is even easier, especially if it gets smaller. I mean, in some situations that's fine. If you have more HP and your opponent's mother takes some damage, you still have more HP, that's good. But in this case, there is Strider here, and Strider would chase Matisse's mother down if he tries to go to speed. I'm surprised Popeye didn't chase him that way. He's so much cleverer than me. they seem to spawn backwards. Direction opposite of your direction of your mother's movement, but that's not always the case, not 100%. Not entirely sure what I learned from that. I mean, I think that's what Popeye is doing, like that when he goes to the middle and he knows he's gonna have less of a bank. I mean, that's entirely fine, but I want to feel comfortable. When I play, I want to feel comfortable, so you know, I select situations where I don't feel
like I'm behind in any way, because you know, bonus pool doesn't really matter all that much. Well, actually, maybe not. Maybe it's about minimizing risk. Because if you have bonus pool, because let's be honest, like in battles like this, Strider versus Strider, there are always situations where you have spigot too long, so you need to have a bank. The decision that you would require to have, if it was without a bank, without that, basically bank gives you further range on your mothers that you can chase down, and I think that's valuable. I think with some maps like Edge of Winter, when you're in bottom, for example, I'm not entirely sure. There are so many ways you can go to the middle on Edge of Winter that I'm not sure if it's bottom or top that can be disadvantaged at some point. But you're gonna be on less bank or less HP. Maybe your protein will spawn a bit later, but it all works out because of the way the middle and on Edge of Winter is designed. So yeah, you can afford to be on short bank or whatever, and there are two spigots very very close on Edge of Winter in the middle, so it's not chasing, it's not really a big problem. But I think on maps that actually allow you to go somewhere other than middle, you might want to consider going somewhere else if your bank will be shorter. It depends how you feel about your opponent, what kind of game you feel you're more capable of beating them in. If it's if someone has weaker micro than you, you might want to try to one mother rush them. If someone has weak macro, you obviously want to go for a macro game. So here both players actually go for their spigot number one in their main. I usually rush to spigot number two. I guess I should try around different ways to do it. It's gonna be tough at the finals, that's for sure. Finals versus one. And Goo versus Goo. I've lost to pretty much people who aren't even, never even been close to going somewhere, or like 200 or something like that. Goo versus Goo. It can happen, obviously, you make mistakes. You're not gonna lose to someone like 200 if you don't make mistakes, but mistakes happen, especially at a live tournament. I think I have a lot of experience doing live tournaments, I think I'll have a bit of an edge there. Obviously not as much as Mista or Matisse. I think they've been to a lot more live tournaments than me. But yeah, Popeye actually picks up this one as well. I usually just go straight through here. Grotta is actually one of my weaker Goo versus Goo maps. So it actually makes Popeye give up this location, which I think is an important location. I actually won a couple of games on Grotta recently by, as I said, going this. Against Goo players, good players like Magic or Matisse, I think both of them on Grotta. I think this part is important because it allows you to build bank, and it also gives you this heal, which sort of forces your opponent into risking being caught or having to build Radiant. Well, obviously no one's gonna build Radiance in that kind of rush, except maybe me, Blues. But also this is pretty thin hallway. So, you know, if your opponent is chasing your Striders down this way, you can actually catch maybe some of his Striders here. So I think this position is very important on this map. But yeah, because it's my weakest map, I think Ngurs is good. This is would be pretty interesting to check out different passes. Even though I have all the wrists and I can play as much as I would like. Confidence is very important. If you doubt yourself, stress will gonna make you, play worse. So let's not watch any more of his replays because obviously he's not playing 100%. Trickster versus Magic. Which is Dallas versus Magic. It's really hard for me, like in StarCraft you watch your play of someone losing, like for example the third player losing. You can actually learn a lot from that, but in Grey Goo I feel like you can't actually, because losses of time as snowball out of, you know, small mistakes snowball into losses. And the losses oftentimes just, you know, devastating. So let's watch this replay on Edge of Winter. Alright, why not? Probably one of the most balanced maps in the game. Actually makes it for a very interesting human versus blue game, and also versus beta. It doesn't give beta the kind of outright advantage that most other maps do when it comes to Russian. It also doesn't really allow human players to play super greedy. But does allow a human player to sort of strategically push out into those expansions and quite often with you, you get some interesting games. I mean, I've seen the Red King play on this map. More than capable of winning this map against any group, even though obviously if you ask any human player this map in favor. I just think it's better. So this might be the best map in the map all right now. Shame that there was no tweaks or even outright replacements for map on the first of this tournament. I mean, it became pretty clear, you know, the balance was sort of back and forth, but it became pretty clear right away that the maps weren't up to high standards that this tournament would probably require. People complained, especially against Goo versus Goo, that, you know, a lot of maps are just basically rush for the center. There has been a bit more variety now than there was before, and, with the exception of probably Edge of Winter and Scarred Plateau, people generally do go for creative passes. So pretty standard split into two mothers, refinery. Which is I think what it's a build that makes a match about if you open two refineries as human. I think if you open two refineries as human, you're too far ahead. Unless you're on a map where you're disadvantaged, like on a coastlands. Well, coastlands is an extreme example. But yeah, unless you're on a map that is bad for human, I think two refinery opening just gives you such a huge advantage over a good player. So I think if a map is good, if a map you know allows a human player to macro, and but at the same time allows the good player to rush, this kind of build refinery factory refinery would provide for the most balanced human versus good match. Third refinery, third refinery is on one factory. Mother split. You go for harassment because, yeah, on this one, Stalker's Rise. It's actually extremely important that that you as a actually, that got me thinking about something else. To play against Mista style of human, Mista has like a very different style of human. He just sends like one revolver at all your mothers, and you know you can't really defend that because they need an entire protein to kill one revolver. So you get behind economically. Yeah. Anyway, on this one, on Stalker's Rise, you actually do have to. Like it's mandatory to do aggression from others, because if you don't, your opponent will just build up defenses here and build their defenses here, and because of how strong human static defenses are, you will not be actually able to prevent them from expanding, because to have map control still, you would have to split your army in two to go control both right and left. And that's simply impossible until the later stage of the game, so you have to start harassing from others. Basically, that's what makes, I think, this map balanced in human versus goo, as opposed to most other people believe. I think this kind of positioning for expansions that force goo to split their attention into two places at once, because goo's strength is in big mass of units. So that's why Mista's human versus goo works, because he forces goo to split the army. And I think the same would work with just expansions on Stalker's Rise or here. You force your goo opponent to go left, right, left, right. The army is more than half as effective when split into two. So this is my big. Like 9 times out of 10, you just won't do any damage here. So, well, this one extractor, I have picked off this extractor, but I think the only reason is because Dallas is going for howitzers, I think, and otherwise he would have a lot of army, and the striders are just so damn slow that they cannot escape, they cannot run away. So you're gonna lose quite a few striders just running from human tier 1. So I think don't be greedy. I only start going for this particular extractor when human tries to expand that to both sides, and I have enough army to attack both sides at the same time. Then you sort of distract them on the left side and you go kill this extractor. But I think in this position it's a bit risky. Oh, he's not attacking for it, he just stayed in there, I didn't understand why. I mean, I'm not against it, I just think, again, you know, the only reason I'm speaking out against this particular move on Magic's part is because Striders are so slow. So any attack with Striders pretty much is yeah, he's been doing good splitting into mothers, and he's sending one mother here, I just don't think it's actually good, because again, mothers are slow. If you're gonna get chased down, you're gonna lose a whole mother, and that's usually very, very devastating. Oh, they just destroyed it. Build that mother. That's decent. I'm not entirely sure. I usually stay on for marches longer, but Dallas didn't have any army. So I'm not sure if that's the correct call to just stay for the four small proteins, you essentially deny yourself two mothers, because you know, two small proteins as one mother. That's a big deal. So you know, you have to do damage that is worth two mothers to the human player. So you have to control those extractors. And I think oftentimes this amount of striders will not be enough to do that. But I assume Magic knew what he was doing. He realized unusual state between the two parts of the galaxy. It's large. When you see this kind of build with Candid Minds and Quick Alpha, you need to go for large protein bank up and kill their Candid lines with large proteins. But Dallas has tanks. I'm not sure how I would react to Dallas having Gladii and seeing stealth attachment. I mean, it would cross my mind that just because of the way stealth attachment, I think if he was going for any kind of artillery units, an attachment would be simply like here or here. This kind of attachment structure does signal that you're building an alpha, because you need to build it this way if you want to attach all attachments to your large factory. If large factory is attached to conduit, you cannot attach all necessary add-ons to it. So Dallas was signaling alpha, but you know, when you're saving up for large proteins and the human player has large economy and he's going for tier 1, just very, very hard to defend him without actually being prepared with your proteins, because by the time proteins would rally up and then transform, and then the units that spawn out of them would regen HP, it would be very, very difficult to defend healthy human economy attack. I don't know. I mean, the option is really the thing that needs to be said is probably there should be better ways to scout, at least for Goo. Should there be better ways to scout for other races? I'm not sure. But I'm not sure how to react here either. Sending one large protein over this wall, I mean one small protein over this wall to scout, I would probably do that. I mean, it's normal for a human player to actually be aggressive in that position. I mean, Red King oftentimes would do. That was my biggest problem with Red King, because I would have loved my games versus him if I could just sit back and we would go like back and forth with attacking each other. But I mean, maybe there is a way. Maybe if you're like a better player than I am, maybe you can figure out by the look of the army if they have leftover resources to build in an alpha. But I sort of felt always like I have to kill Red King by this point. I have like sort of this. I do have like a sense for alpha would be coming out probably soon now if he was going for alpha. So I would often engage in unnecessary attack because I just couldn't scout his mech, couldn't see what he was doing, and that's a problem. Alpha creates a lot of problems for a good player. Yeah. So maybe I should somehow study how much army you can actually build if you're going for. If you're going for alpha. But yeah, scouting is a problem. Anyway. Residents have really large stuff. So when you put small protein over the wall for scouting, you should transform it into radiant so you can see further on.
People didn't know how to beat it really, combat mines seemed even maybe overpowered. But Intel created this build order where people could build large proteins. You don't even have to have 12 members. Soon you can come up there that you know, an alpha is being built, you just save up for large proteins and you go and kill combats with large proteins. It used to be that Mendel would actually, you know, do an upgrade, and there was an upgrade where the large proteins would heal each other when they consume structures, and there was an upgrade that when large proteins would like go low on HP, he would transform it into a bastion, and bastion would have an upgrade where they would rampage when they get low on HP. But it's really became then apparent that it wasn't necessary to do those upgrades, and just large proteins, maybe even mothers, if you pull them all together and attack your opponent. You know, all this talk about knowing what kind of army your opponent will have makes me think that I should probably try playing other races, because I played like 1,000 games total, and I think most of them were with Gu. But I feel that like probably after 600 games with go even less. I said I hit that roof where I couldn't really improve much more. Like I understood how go was played, and you know, when I was playing more, maybe I was improving, but very, very slightly. I think that would have been the point where I should have been playing other races and learning how they work. Because when you actually play other races, then you sort of actually at the point where you learn build orders, optimized build orders, maybe you're not, you know, the best at executing them or whatever, but when you get to that point, you actually do have this awareness of what different things mean. You know, this amount of army means this, or that amount of army means that. And you really learn it when you play other races, or when you play a ton of games, like and watch a ton of games. Like, it's available in StarCraft. That's like 53 minutes of replay on that. Oh, wait, what? There is GG right there. How did it appear after? Oh, am I blind? It's the snow. I'm sorry, Dallas. Much GG, much skill. Anyway, that's been like an hour of analyzing plays. Yeah, it's time consuming without the speed up functions like in StarCraft. Yeah, I'm not sure what I learned today. I mean, it's good to look at other players' style. I should also watch more of my own replays. Alright, so that will be it, and I will approve that like as a proper batch of replays. Maybe I'll remember who was casting, maybe not, but probably won't be as relevant either after the tournament. Not sure if I will upload even. Because sometimes I want to talk about stuff that I think I might be using, like if I learn about it, I might be using it in the finals. So much easier I know is subscribe to my YouTube channel. I don't want to tell him my secrets, but yeah, there might be things that I'd like to say for the finals. What would be, I think, interesting also to mention in the replay analysis. So some of those things might actually be uploaded after the tournament finals. But I think not this one. Anyway, this is all.